Everybody, it's time to start here. It's 4 o'clock, 4:04 actually. So I appreciate everybody jumping on the call. Obviously, you know, I'm super excited about our guest today. We got Dave Starman on the call. He's going to be a wealth of knowledge. For those who don't know, he's an NCAA hockey analyst. He played the game. He coached the game. So he's got a wealth of knowledge. So as we go through, again, remember, this is for you. We're doing this for your behalf. So please, if you want to be engaged and involved, you know, type up anything that you want to ask Dave inside of the chat room. Let's use that chat feature to your advantage. A little bit of the housekeeping items before we start diving into it. On my end, we got confirmation from Iceworks that we're going to be able to be running our camps this summer. So we have the week-long camp in July, and then we have the night clinic as well in August. So I'm very excited about that. A couple other fun updates where we actually got some ice times coming up here shortly too, which is awesome. Iceworks is opening up slowly. I know Regency is opening up here shortly, and we also got some ice time at Winter Sports. So we'll make sure to give you guys all the updates there on that front. Again, we still have to be conscious of everything that's going on. We have to be responsible. So whatever situation we put ourselves in, be responsible. But I don't know about everybody else, but I'm ready to get back on the ice. I'm excited. Mitch, any updates on your front?
Yeah, so along with the rinks opening up, I will be slowly but surely opening up the synthetic studio. The long and the short of it is, for those that don't know, the synthetic studio is in the basement of my house, so I do need to be a little cautious given that my family lives there. But I am going to be doing private lessons, so it'll be one goalie. We're going to go for 45 minutes. And I'll include a spark sharpening before or after, because I'm sure a lot of goalies have not gotten their skate sharpened in quite some time. So those are going to be not on our scheduling site. Those are going to be on demand. So please email me and we'll work it out. I want to make sure that I'm booking it so that there's absolutely no crossover between one goalie and the next. So it's going to be probably a good hour. And I may very well just do one a day. So like I said, if you're interested, please shoot me an email, DM me on Insta or Facebook, and let's get going.
Well, I appreciate the update. I know I'm excited to get back after it. Mitch, I know you are too. But again, we have to just be responsible. But let's shift into the topic of discussion today. Again, let me reiterate how grateful we are to have Dave Starman on the call. Great wealth of knowledge. I'm excited to hear what he has to share. So Dave, I'll pass it over to you. If you don't mind giving us a little story of who you are, and then we can jump into the topic of discussion.
Thanks, Matt. And thanks, Mitch, for having me. Hi, goalies. And my name is Dave Starman. Right now, I am the goaltending development coordinator for New York State, which for that district of USA Hockey. And I've been at this for about 30-something years in terms of just coaching, but obviously being a former goaltender, goalies are my specialties, and it's a soft spot for me. And you guys and gals that are playing goal right now and watching this, I'll tell you what, you're really lucky because you've come along in an era where USA Hockey has done more for goaltender development, not only just for the players, but for their families and for coaches around the country than at any other time in our history. And it started probably about 8 years ago. We were trying to figure out how to incorporate goaltending more into the ADM, and especially in our coaching education program, so that new goaltenders out there would be the benefit of coaches that are much better versed in how to work with goalies, even though they didn't play the position. And a few years back, we were able to create the American Development Model goaltending position, and it has really taken off from there. Right now, Steve Thompson from Alaska, who played at the University of Alaska, is running it. He took over from Phil Ozare, who had played at Ferris State and is now a goaltending development coordinator for the Detroit Red Wings and a scout for them. So the program has really come a long way. And for the families out there that are watching, and for the goalies out there that are watching, www.usahockeygoaltending.com is a great resource, and it took years and years in the making to get it going, but we've got it, and it's a terrific thing for you to take a look at, and especially to recommend sometimes your coaches to take a look at, because there's a ton in there that can help you as you're developing. I was a Division III goalie. I grew up in New York. I was a Division III goaltender. I played at the University of Hartford. The program's gone now. I think we got Title IX, but my claim to fame is in my sophomore year, I had 87 minutes of penalties and 8 assists, and we think that led Division III. The 87 minutes I'm not so proud of. I was a little wound up back in that era, but I defended my crease aggressively, and I think that was one of the key reasons for my success. And the other funny claim to fame I have is I backed up, in a strange way, 3 Vezina Trophy winners in Ole Kolzig, Jim Carrey and Byron Defoe when I was a practice goalie with the Baltimore Skipjacks. So I've been around some good goalies. I was around when Warren Strelo, who's the dean of USA goaltending, when he was the goalie coach of the Washington Capitals, and got a chance to watch Warren do his thing. He used to get on the ice with no skates and no gloves or anything. He used to get out there in his work boots and his hunting vest, and he would develop goalies, and he's one of those guys that helped develop two of those Vezina Trophy winners in Defoe and Colesley back when they played in Washington. So it's been a unique experience for me to kind of ascend into the goalie world. I've gotten a chance to work with some great ones, play with a few great ones, and coach some great ones. And then as it moved along in my general coaching, I've gotten to work with more positional players. But I always felt that the goaltenders are the most underutilized players in practice. I always felt like coaches always hid behind the fact that because they didn't play goal, they couldn't help goalies. And I've always said that the two people who have revolutionized our position, Francois and Benoit Allaire, neither one of them ever played past the high school level of competitive hockey. They were kinesiologists who studied the position and basically developed the way that you're playing now. The neat part about it is I think a little bit of the old style is creeping back into our game. We're teaching a little bit more. There are some parts of the new style, the hybrid style that are out there that I don't love. And there are parts of it from the old style that will never, ever come back. But we're starting to find that you can bring a little bit of the old style back into the new style to make you much more situational and to make you that much more effective as a goalie. And some of the things we're going to talk about, not so much the technical component here, we're going to talk right now about what it is to be a goalie and the preparation component that goes into it. So I'm going to put something up for you just to take a look at. I want to start here. There we go. The one thing about goaltending that I've always felt has been an issue is, and I see it more now, is the lack of accountability of kids in terms of investing in their own career. And all of you goaltenders out there are at that point now where it is so important that you take charge. Mom and dad are important, or stepmom and stepdad are important. Grandma and grandpa may be important. Your legal guardian may be important, whatever the case is. But the bottom line is you're now at that point where it is about you. You've got to take control. You leave a stick at home, that's your problem. You leave your jerseys at home, that's your problem. You didn't get your skate sharpened or didn't plan ahead to get to the rink 10 minutes beforehand, so you get your skate sharpened, that's now your problem. You've got to now really take control of your career and where it's going in terms of whether it be hockey schools, practice, the team you want to play for. And the one thing, I know Mitch is on this call, and Mitch and I have talked a lot in the past about places where his son could possibly play and looking for good programs and making the right decisions. It is worth investing and looking at the programs you're going to play to make sure that A, you're going to play, B, you're going to get coached well, and C, if you're really lucky, there'll be a goalie coach on staff that can help you out. So when we look at some of our topics of discussion, and especially the successful attitude, I want to really go down to those 10 C's of goaltending. And one of them, obviously, is competence. When we talk about competence, can you play the position? Are you doing the things on and off ice that are going to make you a better goalie? Off-ice training, especially right now, and let's talk about coming through this pandemic. Nobody in your life will ever, ever give you 3 months and say to you, go invest in yourself. So I'm hoping over the last 3 months, everybody has grabbed the bull by the horns, whether it be off-ice, whether it be in some areas where maybe you stuck onto the ice early, great. But the off-ice component, whether it be running, jumping, plyos, biking, walking backwards up ramps, running hills, anything that you could do to build up your legs, build up your core strength, hopefully you took some advantage of that. Concentration. We laugh about that. Some of the old guard on this call will laugh about that. We are really in the ADD generation where the attention span has dropped quite a bit. It's a lot, big challenge for a lot of us coaches to be able to engage with an audience, even an adult audience, for a good chunk of time. And we have found that the teenage audience at times, because of the cell phone era and playing games on your phone and the amount of distractions that are out there, it's sometimes really hard to focus. But the important thing for you as players, we call it AOL. It's called the art of listening. And the art of listening is something that can really make you a better player, because if you can lock in what coaches are talking about and what you're hearing, and whether it be lectures or webinars or on-ice situations, it really will bring up that concentration level for you. Control is a big one. I joked about the 87 minutes of penalties. Like I said, I was a little high strung my sophomore year, and I took a lot of dumb penalties, a lot of misconducts, mouthing off at refs or whacking and hacking at guys' ankles. That was kind of that era, the Hextall Billy Smith era, where you could defend your crease a little differently. But you can't do a whole lot of that anymore. Control is important, but more so in the control aspect is mental control, is emotional control. I've been around a lot of goalies that sometimes just lose it. You give up a bad goal or a couple of bad goals, maybe even get pulled out of a game just because you didn't have it that night. Control is important. We always talk about it's about the next save. It's about the next game. It's about the next shot. It's about the next 5 minutes. That's all it's about. We sometimes joke about having a bartender's memory, and that is forgetting what you heard or just happened and focusing on the next thing. So that control part is important, that emotional and mental control when you're in the crease. It's about being able to hit the reset button, park what just happened, and moving forward. Confidence is a big one. If you don't have confidence, this is a really hard position to play. But you could say that about anything in life. And I'll tell you this, goalies that are out there, even if you're going into something for the first time, you're outside your comfort zone, you're playing against older players, you're playing against better players for the first time, get dressed, get on the ice, warm up like you belong there. Always get on the ice that you feel like you belong in the group you're about to play with. Now, if you're 14 and you're playing with pros, that's a bad situation. But if you're 14 and you're playing with the 15s and 16s, get out there like you belong out there. Show a little swagger. Don't be cocky. Don't be overconfident. Don't be like braggadocio, but have some swagger that you belong out there where you are right now. That confidence is important. Consistency. Consistency is something we all strive for. What is consistency about? Well, it incorporates a little bit of what we just talked about. Being consistent is about being confident. It's about taking control of your game. It's about doing things. It's about developing habits. And ask yourself after this call, write down some of the habits that you feel that you have. What are some of the good habits you have? Is it getting to practice early? Is it getting the tennis balls out there and doing your hand-eye coordination before practice and games? Is it getting out there and running and warming up? Is it making sure that you're mentally and physically prepared? Is it making sure that you had a good meal well in advance of your workout? Are you getting proper rest? Are you able to take some of the distractions that are going on in your life out of there so that you can focus on the task in hand? Those are some of the things that build consistency. Communication to me is obvious. I think goalies should be vocal. You guys are leaders and gals are leaders. Be vocal, especially on the ice, whether it be yelling at a defenseman man on or wheel or under pressure or off the glass, whatever the case is, or letting somebody know there's an option. You've got to be talkers out there. To me, I thought it was one of the best things I did. Surprisingly, it led me into a broadcasting career. But I always thought that one of the best things that you could do is be really communicative, whether it be on the bench, in the crease, and in the locker room when you can. Challenge, I think, is self-evident. Courage. Courage sometimes from a younger age group, that's sometimes hard to develop in terms of not being afraid of the puck or being want to get out there and play the big minutes. You should want to get out there. You should want the net for every big game. You should want the net for every big moment. And I think back to the 19th, right now it's this week is the 24th anniversary of the Rangers winning the Cup. And I think about Mike Richter stopping the penalty shot against Pavel Bure in game four when that game and that series were on the line. And I keep thinking, if I'm Mike Richter, the courage that he showed to make the save that he made against probably one of the top five goal scorers in the league at that time, Pavel Bure, that's courage and that's what you need. Conditioning, we talked about that a little bit. That's obvious. This is a hard position to play unless you're in really good shape. And lastly, coaching. Coaching's important. You're going to wind up in and around a lot. There are more good goalie coaches out there now than there ever have been, but they're not the be-all and end-all. Use the resources that are available to you. Online, there is a ton out there. USA Hockey's put out a ton of great stuff. Independent goalie coaches have put out a ton of great stuff. Get on the internet, look up some of these sites, and take a look at some of the technique that's going on there. You could also learn a lot by watching games. Now, I grew up in New York City. We didn't have goalie coaches back in my era, which was the early 80s. So I learned to play goal by watching Billy Smith and Ed Jockman and John Davidson and John Van Biesbroek and Kelly Rudy, all those goalies that play in the New York area. Those were the guys I watched, and I would sit at games and I'd just watch them. Or when games were on TV, I'd sit there and I'd watch them. That's how I learned how to play the position. You could do a lot by emulating the guys you're watching and then checking in with the goalie coaches that are available to you, or even just the coaches that have shown a good interest in knowing how to work with your goalies as you go along. So I'm going to change screens for a second and go into a sidebar here. And that is my important tips for young goalies. Okay, so number one, a couple of you guys on the call played with my son Ryan last year with PAL. And you certainly know that I'm a guy that believes in being prepared. I always talk about being prepared. And the one thing that I did as a kid, as a goalie, I used to, when I packed my bag, I used to get dressed into my bag. And I always used to get, the way that I got dressed in the locker room was the way that I packed my equipment. So whether it be my long underwear and then my skates and then my chest protector and then my helmet, then my gloves, whatever the way I got dressed was, I got dressed into my bag. So that way I knew that I had everything. But it's more now. There's a lot more going on right now. So when you are getting ready to pack up and go to the rink for a game or a practice, maybe you put a checklist in your bag. You laminate a checklist or you put it on an index card and put it in a Ziploc bag so it doesn't get wet, because you might add to it as you're going along. Do you have everything you need to be successful at the rink? Ice time's expensive. Games are expensive. Road trips are expensive. Staying over is expensive. You want to make sure that you max out the opportunity that you're getting on the ice. So be prepared in terms of making sure that you have everything that you need. And included in that is making sure everything is in good shape. This is something, when I talk about invest in your career, this is one of the things I'm talking about. Invest in your equipment. Equipment is not cheap. And coming out of what we just came through with people not working and bills getting more expensive, make sure that you max out the equipment that you have. Check your pads and make sure that the stitching is good. Check your buckles. Make sure that all the screws are tied in, your helmet screws are in. You've got extra string for your hanging cage, that you maybe have an extra hanging cage in your bag in case one breaks in a game. Your gloves are in good shape. Your skates aren't rusting. Your skates are sharp. Whatever piece of equipment you have that you're using, make sure it's in good shape well before you leave for the rink, because the condition of that equipment can change from Friday night to Saturday afternoon because of the last ice session that you had. So just make sure that all that stuff is good. We talk about with the new normal at the moment, your pre-practice routine, make sure your body's prepared. You know about that. On the ice, don't waste time. I really think, and I've talked to all players about this, go have a plan that what you want to do on the ice that day and share that plan with your coaches. Sometimes you may want to work on your glove hand. You may want to work on your blocker. You may want to work on your five hole. You may want to work on stick use. You may want to work on your sliding and hitting your marks. Go to your coach before practice and say, maybe this is an area that I'm not really feeling strong in right now. I need to work on this. So during the drills, I may overplay or over exaggerate or do something along the lines that's a little out of the norm, but I'm working on a specific thing and I'm hoping that you could support me as I do this during practice. I'm obviously going to compete. I'm going to play. But there are some things I want to work on. So go through it with them. Maybe go through it with your goalie coach. But I really feel like if you drill down on a specific topic for yourself every practice, you're going to become a much better goalie because, you're once again, you're investing and taking charge of your career. Compete management. I kind of like this one. And when I talk about this, is let me move it down for you. Hang on one second. I did a panel at the Level 5 Symposium, the Masters Symposium, a couple of years back for USA Hockey. John Van Biesbroek and Mike Richter were in that panel, two goalies who were both very similar and very different in terms of the way that they played, and both great American-born goalies, two of the best we've ever had. And one of the things we talked about was practice. And Mike and John joked about when they were together with the Rangers, that playing for some of the coaches they played for, and it even happened later on, there would be such an emphasis on flow, 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 and shot, 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 that the two of them would be exhausted, and that there were times where they were literally just surviving as opposed to playing the position. And that doesn't help you, because that's where your structure breaks down. That's where your stance breaks down. That's where your habits break down, because if you can't breathe, you can't play. So the one thing that John talked about a lot about was, A, he really feels like at the USHL level and higher, extra goalies on the ice during practice is probably a good thing because it keeps everybody fresh and it keeps everybody sharp. College, we see that. But for you as young goalies, if you've got two of you out there and you're in a practice where it's nothing but flow and shots and you're not getting maybe what you need, it is really hard to play this position if you can't breathe. So the suggestion that I've always made is compete for five shots and then let five pucks find you and then start all over again. Or maybe you go for five and you take eight and then you go for five again. But you want to make sure that everything you do, you're doing for a purpose, especially when you're dialed in. If you, like I said, if you can't work out of a set position where you're bracing and ready for shots, where your technique's going to improve, let the puck find you. It's okay. You can bail on a few shots because you're catching your breath, especially if coaches aren't realizing that you might need some air or you might need some water. The stretching component. I take pride in the fact that I'm 52 years old and I can still do a split. But that's the way we played my era. And Mitch, you can certainly understand, you know, coming from the 80s and early 90s as a 5'9 goalie, if I didn't have reflexes and flexibility, I don't play. So I had a much different probably a different strategy than a lot of the young goalies out there are having, where you guys are using the front of your pads a whole lot more than my era did. We used everything. But I still believe that stretching is important. You've got to be flexible. You've got to be limber. They talk about stretching might not necessarily prevent an injury, but it's certainly going to accelerate the recovery for one. So being limber, being strong, being flexible to me is important. And it's also really, really relaxing. I found that a good 20-minute stretch on a game day really got my mind ready to play. I felt that a good cool-down stretch after a game or a practice really let me separate myself from the workout and go back to my regular day. I still feel it that way in the gym. My pre-game, my pre-workout stretch and my post-workout stretch introduced me into my workout, and they also let me leave my workout behind and move back into the other sections of my day. So I suggest for you goalies out there, stretch. Make sure you get a good pre-game stretch, get a good post-game stretch. Don't waste a lot of time stretching on the ice, because ice is expensive. So if you're out there, we want to be moving and working as opposed to stretching. And most important, gang, you're a leader out there. I have yet to meet a goalie that's not a leader. If the way you give up a goal, believe it or not, makes an impact on your team. It could be a bad goal. That's fine. How'd you react to it? Did you slam your stick? Did you lay there on the ice? Did you go? Did you play palms up hockey and go like this? Did you tell your defenseman, hey, you're in my way, I couldn't see that, that you can't do that to me? It's how you react to adversity that really defines your leadership skills. And to me, you give up a goal, act like you've been there before. Act like it's not that big a deal. It goes in, pull out of the net, get back up, get ready. Go for a little skate around the net to the corner, get back in there and get set. Show your team that you're ready. And if it's a bad goal, and listen, we all give up bad goals, me more than anybody. If you give up a bad goal, say to your team, boys, my bad. I owe you one. That's on me. And if you're in a league where you get a flood between periods, you could all sit down. You could do the same thing. Hey, guys, that third one, that was all me. No, my bad. I owe you one. But also communicate. Tell your defenseman where you want them. If you got a defenseman that likes the front up, let him know he's in your way. Yell, scream. You could talk to your Ds beforehand saying, hey, you get into a two-on-one, I want the shot, you take the pass. Or you could say to them, you get into a two-on-one and you think you could use the slide and take away the passing option and shot option, low ice, you do it, and I'll make sure I get across the net if anything happens. Communicate with your Ds. Communicate with your Ds and your coach to make sure you're all on the same page. But make sure you talk to people. I think communication right now in this generation is lacking. So the more that you talk, the more you engage in discussion, the more that you air out your concerns and your ideas and your theories with your teammates and your coaching staff, I think the better it's going to make you, and it's going to set you up for long-term success. Remember, you are not playing for tomorrow. You are not playing for next week, and you're not playing for the end of the season. This is a marathon, not a sprint. The finish line for a lot of us serious players is college hockey, hopefully. That's your finish line. So don't rush to get to the end of the season. Don't do everything just thinking that everything you need to do is about hanging a banner this year. It's not. Everything you're doing right now is to get ready for next year. And then everything you do next year is to get ready for the year after that. Because hopefully everybody out there is looking at the opportunity of Division I, Division III, or really good club college hockey. And it's attainable with the amount of teams that we have out there and the amount of resources that you have. So just make sure that you're dialed in for your preparation. And with that, I will turn it back over.
Well, my goodness. There's not too many times that we get speakers on that I 100% agree with everything they say, but I 100% agree with everything that you just went over. We've had a lot of good speakers on for this goalie doctor discussion, the time where we're trying to fill up our time in COVID. But, you know, some of the points of discussion was always coming back to, how do I be a high-level goalie? And if you want to be a high-level goalie, rewatch that and study it and take notes. You know, we always ask for, how do we get to that next level? Well, if you want high-level thinking, high-level guidance, everything that Dave just went over is exactly the recipe to be successful and find success. And I'm listening to him talk, and, you know, I was a 5'9 goalie. I'm smaller, so I'm liking some of the things that he was saying. And listening to that and taking my coach's hat off and kind of sitting back and almost being a player again, everything that he went over is the same things that went through my mind when I was trying to be a high-level athlete. You know, the 10 Cs, that comes into play so importantly. You know, concentration, big piece, massive piece. this position that we play is so very challenging. There's so many variables that we have to be able to identify and be able to find a solution for really quick. So that concentration piece is not only just focusing on that puck and stopping the puck, but also being aware of so many things that are outside that one job, right? We have to be able to identify opportunities that are going to come against us. We have to find and identify threats and be able to communicate those to our teammates in a competent way, not just splurting out instructions and yelling out different things, but actually having meaningful communication in a split second. And that requires such concentration. And it comes back to, again, what you guys do every day. And I know most of the things that Dave touched on, hopefully for the goalies that work with me and Mitch, hopefully it sounds like a little bit of repetitive because I loved all the things that he said. And, you know, there's so many pieces that I would love to just go over again. But, you know, courage is important. Another big one. You know, I was a small goalie. My big piece was I was fearless. Every time I stepped on the ice, I knew, I told myself I belonged. And some days you were out on the ice and you didn't feel like you belonged, but you kept telling yourself that. I kept telling myself that. And one day I started to belong. And sometimes it takes that courage to put yourself in a position that you may fail. But having the confidence to be able to get outside of your comfort zone is really the underlying differentiator between some of the players that I've played with that either went on to Division I, Division III, or a high-level college, or fizzled out and just played, you know, 18 or high school and just moved on to men's league. So again, it's really down to you. Like, what is your choice as a goaltender? Do you want to play hockey or you want to be a hockey player, right? There is a difference in my mind, and there's nothing wrong at all. If this is a good outlet for you to grow, make friends, enjoy yourself. And again, the most important piece of this is always to have fun. But my definition of fun was I wanted to be the best. That was fun for me. So every situation I put myself into, I wanted to either outwork the person that's working harder than me, outperform the goaltender that was supposedly better than me, and get to the point where someone stepped on the ice with me and said, man, I want to be that. I got to compete against him. You know, and that comes down to your confidence, and it's making sure, you know, where do you gain confidence? You gain confidence from yourself, your habits, your preparation, you know, going into things that are so simple as packing your bag. Everybody, every single goaltender, every coach, everybody that's involved in hockey has one time or another made a simple mental mistake and forgot something.
Hey, Matt.
Yep.
Let me just share a quick story on that topic, goalies. And this is, you'll get a kick out of this. First start I ever made in college. I remember that morning I was down at the rink and I gave the trainer my skates to sharpen. Well, we got to the rink that night that we were playing in and my skates weren't in my bag. And I went to our trainer and I said, where are my skates? And he goes, probably on my sharpener. And so I made my NCAA debut wearing the skates of the other team's number three goalie, which were a half size too big and cut differently than the way I play them. From that moment on, I packed my bag everywhere I went. So take no chances.
Yeah. And my lesson, when I learned how to pack my bag, I was, I think I was 13 or 14. And we were, at that time, my dad was a goalie coach too. So we're running around different rinks and whatever. And I believe it was a Saturday into a Sunday and we had a clinic. So Saturday I went over to a buddy's place, forgot my pants, showed up to the rink, didn't know I'd forgot my pants. So I started getting dressed, come out of the locker room. I said, Dad, I don't have my pants. He's like, well, you're probably going to get hurt today. I'll see you on the ice. I practiced and I can tell you from that point on, one, I never forgot to pack my bag properly. And two, for that practice, my hands were on point. I didn't get hit anywhere inside of my body because I was so fierce. Fearful. But from that point on, you know, everyone has to learn the lesson. But again, listen to what we're trying to tell you. Our experiences of going through some of these learning lessons are trying to give you the opportunity not to make the same mistakes. And again, preparation, commitment, those are all pieces that go into it. And it starts with packing your bag. Mitch, I'll let you jump in. Do you have any points or discussion or questions for Dave?
I mean, honestly, I mean, you guys really covered everything. I mean, and Matt, as you kind of pointed out, I mean, Dave pretty much echoed the things that we say to all of our goalies, you know, about being accountable, about playing with a purpose, about, you know, packing your bag properly, checking your equipment. Obviously, for me, the one thing that really stood out with Dave said, which, you know, gives me confidence in myself, is the fact that the Allaire brothers never played high-level hockey. just like myself. So
neither did Mitch Korn.
And Mitch Korn, the other Mitch. I'm the Mitch. He's the other Mitch at this point.
I mean, there's so many coaches that haven't played at a high level. You don't need to play at a high level to know how to coach, to teach, to connect.
Correct. So, but I don't want to beat a dead horse, but I mean, everything that Dave said is spot on. I mean, and goalies, I want you to understand something that with Dave, you know, the one thing that I don't know we really discussed, he was also a scout for the Montreal Canadiens. So he knows his stuff. He's been around a long time. Actually, Dave, can you talk a little bit about your experience with Canadians and what it's like to be a scout and what you look for?
Absolutely. And I'll specifically about what we look for in goalies. And, you know, I've scouted for a couple of different organizations. The most recently it's been, I'm now with NHL Seattle, which has been great. It's we would joke about it's the most relaxing job because we don't win or lose. You know, we're undefeated. You know, I was with the Toronto Maple Leafs for 4 years. I was with the Montreal Canadiens for 4 years, and they were eight of the greatest seasons I've ever spent, you know, with two iconic franchises, and I savored every day that I was with them. But the, you know, when I was in Toronto, I'll tell you a story, kids. When I was in Toronto, there was a goalie who was playing at Cornell. His name was Ben Scrivens, who some of you might have heard of. He retired a couple of years ago. And, you know, I watched Ben for a long time, and my first year with Toronto was Ben's senior year. And NCAA free agency was my area. And I started beating down the door in our meetings about how much I wanted to sign Ben Scrivens as a free agent. I really felt like he was the real deal. I felt like at the very least, he was going to be a solid number two goalie at the NHL. He was big. He was quick. He was athletic. He used his legs really well. He was great with a stick in terms of getting pucks low on the ice in the corners. He caught pucks, which I think right now a lot of young goalies struggle with because of the way that the gloves are made and how hard they are to close at times. But he caught pucks well. Again, I liked his rebound control. He was vocal on the ice. He was a leader, and he won big games. So I just loved the way he competed. So, and that went from his freshman year where he was a rebound machine. I mean, all he did was kick pucks all over the rink, and he really changed his game, and he became a really good goalie. And I'll never forget this. His last game as a collegian was at the Albany Regional in 2010, and they lost. They were favored, and they lost to New Hampshire, and he was dreadful. And I remember getting a call from my boss in Toronto, who was sitting on the other side of the ice watching the game. He calls me up as soon as Scrivens got pulled, and he says, "You sure about this one?" And I said, "Yes, I'm positive." And Ben went on to have a good career. The other goalie that I was responsible for getting signed as a pro was Charlie Lindgren, who's now with the Montreal Canadiens. Charlie was a free agent goaltender at St. Cloud State University, and I liked a lot of the same things. Charlie was big and lanky and competitive and a late bloomer, you know, and something, guys, both Ben and Charlie have in common that you might feel is something with you, they were late bloomers in terms of the fact that they grew late, they got tall late, and they might not have had a whole lot of eyeballs on them when they were 14, 15, 16 years old. And you know what, guys, gals, that's okay. That's fine. If you're not getting a ton of interest right now, that is okay. The goaltending position is a late matriculation position, meaning that you're going to develop into your goaltending maturity later on in your career. And goalies at the NHL level, when they hit their prime, usually about 28, 29, 30 years old. A lot of goalies don't hit their real prime or sustain it until they hit those later ages because you're mentally, physically, emotionally mature enough to handle the rigors of the position. So when I talk to you about just keep playing, that's what guys like Lindgren did or what Scrivens did. They just kept playing. They just kept getting better. They didn't go seek out the best team to play for. When Scrivens played at Cornell was a good team, but they weren't a national championship contender. When Charlie Lindgren was at St. Cloud really started to make a run, but they had some hiccups. And Charlie's last game wasn't great either. I got the same call from my boss in Montreal. Are you sure about this? And I said, yes. And Charlie's went on to have a pretty good career. So the message here, and what we look for as scouts in terms of young goalies is a lot of what we talked about. Composure, compete, concentration, body language, leadership. I like to sit down low when I watch a college game at times. If I'm watching the goalie specifically, I want to hear how much the goalie talks. I want to hear if he's vocal. If he doesn't say a word all game, I get nervous because that means either A, he's too afraid to talk, or he's too locked in to think about anything else. That lack of communication worries me. And Scrivens and Lindgren are both great communicators. So those are some of the things from my scouting career that I look at. And when we hit the trail next year, there'll be things that we're looking at because that Seattle organization is going to need six or seven goalies to get started with. So, you know, it's kind of a buyer's market for us.
That's awesome. You know, one thing that I think we didn't touch on, and I think this is kind of like the other side of the equation. I think everything we want on is all the things that we want to try and do. Since you're such a wealth of knowledge, I'll propose this to you. Is there any common mistakes or things that our goalies that are doing that you disagree with or think that are counterproductive?
Are we tactically or just developmentally?
Tactically.
All right. As Mitch and I have joked about, I am not a big fan of the RHV on dead angle shots. And when I talk about dead angle shots, those are shots that are just above the bottoms of the faceoff circles, just above the goal line, underneath the dots, where the player, for the most part, is either coming out of the quiet zones behind the goal line or is really wide off to the side boards and below the hash marks. Those are dead angle, non-dangerous shots. And I know what we're teaching now, and I understand it. It's funny, Joe Exter, who's the assistant coach and a great goalie coach at Michigan State, Joe and I argue about this all the time because he likes the move. I don't like the RHV because I feel like any time that you're facing a shot, your toes, or in this area, your knees and shoulders, should be squared to the shot. And when you're in the RHV, you're not. And to me, especially for younger goalies that haven't hit 6'3 yet, you're leaving a top part of the net wide open. And where are shooters now finding most of the room to shoot? They're shooting high because they know that you've got the low ice covered. And the big goalies like Ben Bishop at 6'7", when he goes down, he's got the whole net covered. The only place you're going to find space is at the top of the net. So if you're shooting a score, you're shooting for the tops of the nets. And when you go into that RHV too early, you are opening up the door. And if you've ever watched a game that I broadcast, I know you guys, a couple of you guys have, when I see a bad RHV goal, I get on a tirade and I see at least one a game. And when I'm pre-scouting games, I see at least one a game. I don't like the RHV. I think if a puck is in a dead angle, a bad angle, by the boards, below the goal line, but way off to the side outside the dots, you need to be on your feet. That's one of my big pet peeves of the way we're teaching goalies today.
Dave, is this why you like Charlie Lindgren? Because I know he rarely, if ever, uses RVH.
Yeah, I told Charlie I'd kill him if I saw him do it. But Charlie, here's the thing. Charlie's a guy that's really confident in his feet. Like, I used to call him the spider because I was convinced that no matter where he was, he found a leg to make another save with. And there were days I thought he had eight of them. You know, it was amazing. But he was able to do that because he didn't give up his feet too early. He was one of the few that played that hybrid style. It wasn't down too early. And the nights that he was down too early, I just knew he didn't have it and I left. But when I knew he was on, he was up on his feet, and you're right. He the more he can face shots while he's up, great. He's also a backwards goalie, and he uses that to his advantage.
So before we jump, we have a couple clips that we can go over and talk about. But before we do, I want to propose one more question. And I think we kind of talked about this, and it kind of comes back to the principle of communication. But me being on the ice and Mitch being on the ice with a lot of different teams and organizations, I see a lot of times where coaches or head coaches, like you touched on, throw goalies in the net and say, go stop the puck. More goalies have more resources, more coaching, and more education to be able to bridge the gap somewhere. So how do you propose a younger goalie that doesn't have a goalie coach for within their organization, that maybe have a coach that's never played the position and doesn't really allocate a lot of time to goalies? How do you propose that a goaltender in that situation can bridge the gap and get the coach on board or find a way to find a happy medium between them?
It's a great question. And goalies, here's the answer to it. Pay attention to this because it's going to help your career. And this is what I talk about with taking or investing in your career. If you've got a coach that you like, that you've got a rapport with, that you can talk to, or an assistant coach, then what you want to do is, if you know what you need at the beginning of practice to work on, you need to talk to your coach before practice, or you maybe even call him earlier that day or send him a text. Hey, I really would like to work on shots low on the ice that I can use my stick to work on. Let's say that's what it is. And I've got three drills that I can show you, and I need a couple of shooters and one coach to help me do them. Are you willing to allow me 10 minutes before practice, you know, when we get on the ice, so that I can do this while you're doing something else with the guys, you know, maybe skill work? And I got news for you. You go to your coach or your assistant coach with a plan that where they don't have to think about what has to happen. The onus is not on them to come up with something to like entertain you and work with you. Then you know what? They're really going to respect you. I loved it when I was coach, especially at the pro level. I loved it when players came to me and said, hey coach, you know, before we get on the ice for practice, can you come out with us for 15 minutes? We want to work on this. And here are a couple of things you want to do. I thought that was great because it gave them ownership of their development. So if you can come up with two or three things that you might want to do before practice, or when you get on the ice before practice gets really flowing, then go to your coach and say, hey, can we do this? 9 times out of 10, that coach has a brain in his head, knowing how important it is, a position that you play, they're going to figure out a way to work with you.
I love it. I appreciate that, and thank you for communicating that. I used to love when my players come to me and say, this is what we want to work on. And now, you know, to kind of keep that full circle, every time we do lessons, that's the first question I ask. Hey, so-and-so, what do you want to work on today? And whenever they come to me and say, hey, I want to work on this, this, and this, they take ownership. They're more involved and invested. The last thing I want to hear is, I don't know, let's go do whatever. So it means that you're more prepared. And just like Dave said, if you're going to go to a coach and be prepared and be professional like that, 9 times out of 10, everyone's going to be super excited that you're so involved and invested in yourself, and they'll help and assist. So Mitch, why don't we pull up the video? Dave, if you're good with this, I would love to show a few clips and then we can have a little bit of a discussion.
Absolutely.
Perfect.
All right, here we go.
Mitch, why don't you explain what's the situation that we're watching?
So today, all the goals, that every week we've done a different theme, and what we're going to do this week is goals that come off the rush. So basically, this is a play that develops outside of the zone and then develops into a scoring opportunity, and all of these, there are no rebounds. These are clean shots that go in. So the things that we want to look at, goalies, is we want to look at what was his positioning. Is the goalie aware of what his surroundings are, or does he have a puck vision where he's just locked in on the puck? Does he know what's around him? How does he react? Does he slide? Does he get there on his feet? What's his depth? What's his angle? So let's go right into it. So obviously you can see the play is developed in the other zone.
Ooh. All right, so we got a good goaltender in net too.
And I like what he did. He went from aggressive depth to a deep depth, reading the play. He's on his feet, dead angle. When that pass comes across, he's in a great spot. Look what he did with his glove, though. And this is what I talk about with glove hands. I just find glove hands, just with the where it's sitting, sometimes it's really hard to use your glove hand in that spot, and shooters know it. So, and listen, Bob is a hell of a goalie, so I'm not going to pick on his style. It's got him where he's gotten. But the reason that this puck goes in, he's got his glove in front of his body, but he's got it more up and down than off to the side, so he can't really use it. So the first reaction of where he's going to pull his hand is in, not out. See where it is? So look where it goes. It goes in, not out, on the shot. So he's covering covered space. He's taking away – he's covering an area that he's kind of got covered a little bit. Look where his glove is. His glove is in front of his body. It's not open and out to the point where it's a distraction – to the shooter. He got it up late, but he didn't get it up where he wanted it. As soon as he pulls it down right there, that to me opens up the door for a good shooter to say, hey, I know that he is coming up.
So Patrick jumped in. He said he's more square to the body rather than the puck. And we'll get a second chance to look at that. But I think that's a good breakdown of why the goal went in. I mean, to be honest, no, he's reading the play pretty well. He starts aggressive as he enters the zone. As that play starts to become less and less a threat, and obviously they got good coverage. They got two guys there forcing him all the way out to the boards, right around the hash mark. Not really a heavy threat. So we get to change our depth, come back to our post, have a better opportunity to assess the situation. Pass goes out to the point. Does a great job exploding, getting out, top of the crease, toes in the white. Set his feet. He's just a little slow, a little bit of almost like a mental hitch where he gets his glove, taps it, and brings it back down. That half second where you're getting prepared allows the shooter to have that half second advantage. And
Matt, the other thing on this one, because you're bringing up a good point, Patrick, nice point by you. There's a concept we talk about, it's called the eyes of the shooter, the eyes of the puck. What the shooter sees and what the puck sees are very different. And there's really only one place that the shooter can put the puck, and that is short side, because that's what the puck sees. The puck is only seeing net on the short side of the ice. So goalies, keep in mind, as you're squaring up, think about what the puck is looking at. Think about where the open space is concerning where the puck on the ice is, as opposed to where the shooter's eyeballs are. There are two. Mitch Harris used to call it the shooter's illusion Jim Park used to call it the shooter's illusion when he did goalie camps back in the 80s. And that's kind of what this is. What does the puck see? versus what are the eyeballs of the shooter see? And can you get yourself in a spot where you're forcing him to put the puck in an area that the puck can't find?
Perfect. Again, these guys are NHL caliber players. There's not a lot of space to put it there, and he picks it. But again, these are great teaching tools for you as a goaltender. Now, these are the best players in the world, and they make simple mistakes. And if you can identify that at such a high level, it allows you to have a little bit better understanding to measure your game, right? We're not going to be perfect, but every opportunity, whether it's a shot or a goal, is an opportunity for you guys to learn. So let's watch the next one.
Must be pick on Bob Day.
Oh. Pasta. All right, so let's watch this again. All right. So, Mitch, what's your take?
So, let me just watch it one more time. I know when I did the video, I don't watch it very much, so let me just...
Hey, Mitch, would I be dating myself? I said the two-pad slide would have been great here.
You know, the funny thing is, it really wouldn't be a bad option.
It's coming back. It's coming back. Like the Pocheck. We're going to bring the Pocheck back, too.
Absolutely.
I think that's so underutilized.
Yeah, so what we have, I mean, what I like about the Bob starts out, he's aggressive, which, I mean, he's a very aggressive goaltender. The one thing that I'm concerned about that you don't really see in the clip is he doesn't really do any kind of shoulder check, so he has no idea of what is out there for that outside threat. So I think that's a big part of it. And you can see he really does not get a strong push. I almost wonder if he even split out of that and just didn't get a push, especially by his reaction. Bob ends up on his stomach, kind of out of position. So I think of a strong push, especially with him, with such a strong skater he is, I think he probably would make that save. But I think the lack of shoulder check might have led to it as well.
And Patrick, great drop in. Even before Mitch said it, actually it was coming out of your mouth. Patrick jumped in and said the same exact thing. Dave, what's your take?
It's funny. It's one of the first things I noticed is you look at first of all, just as a side note, 52 in black is Sean Corrali, who played at Miami University. Look at the way he splits the D and attacks the back of the heels of the short side of the near side defenseman there. That's just a great play to open up space. That made the whole play. But on that, I kind of agree with you guys. First of all, I don't think he had any idea that there was something coming down the wing. And keep in mind, goalies, I like to play the odd-even rule. This more would fit into the even. I feel like if it's an even rush where everybody can be picked up, you can cheat a little bit more and get a little bit more aggressive, play at aggressive depth. If it's an odd situation, you need to sit back a little tighter because of the possibility that you might get backdoored. So while I didn't love – leave it right there for a second. I didn't love the goal. It was not a great back check by Columbus to start with. There wasn't great awareness by Columbus on their back check, and Bobrovsky didn't help himself by taking a look. But from where Pasternak is putting this puck off his stick to the net, you should make a case that either A, he should have been taken, and B, that Bobrovsky probably, with his size and strength, had enough of a push to get over if he knew that Pasternak was coming down as an option.
I'm very happy that you pointed out the middle lane drive. I mean, that is exactly what opens up that passing lane. And then Pasta does get it on his stick, off his stick pretty quick. And that's why he's one of the best players in the NHL. But at the same time, you can see Bob almost like get surprised. He doesn't look like he comes across with confidence.
Now, Mitch, do me a favor. Once the puck goes in, leave it there for a second. Roll it through. Stop. Roll it through for a quick second. Stop. Look what Bobrovsky's doing. Like, and I think he stayed there for another 3-4 seconds. Goalies, when I tell you this is not the way to react to a goal, don't just lay there. Puck goes in, get up. Get up and get ready. Even if it's a bad goal, get up and get ready. Don't ever let another team see you like that, where you're putting your head down and doubting yourself. Get back up. Don't show them that it bothers you.
Dave said it earlier. We've said it before. That next mentality. It went in. Get your water bottle, do your routine that you have to, and move on to the next one. Let's watch the next clip. Again.
This is pick on Bob Day.
I love watching Bob. I'm still sad that the Flyers got rid of him. That was a little jumpy, so I'm going to have to watch again. So 2-on-2. Oh.
Stop it. Oh, go back, Mitch. Go back 1 second. I'm going to give you the whole issue right here. Go back 1 sec. Stop. Now let's just move it up to where you see Bobrovsky start in your frame. Stop. Does he look ready? I mean, does he look even remotely ready for a shot? Sticks in the air. He's standing up straight. I don't care if the shooter's in shooting position or not. That puck crosses the red line. You should be starting to get knees bent and ready. That puck crosses the blue line. You're shot ready. He gave up this goal because he just wasn't set. And this kid, Patrick, you could play for me any day of the week. I love the comments you're making.
He's on it today. But you're right. You know, as he comes in, we talk about this preparation. You know, we need to control the controllables, and we don't want to make this position any more difficult than it has to be and any more difficult than it already is. It's one of the most challenging positions in all sports. And if we're not ready, the puck's going to get on top of you real quick.
And Max, you bring up a good point. Now, that's what we're talking about. I mean, he was right where he should have been, but he was busy. Goaltending should be a quiet position. Be quiet in the net. Let the puck come to you. Take what the game gives you. He's just not ready. He's set. He's in position. He's not ready. And I understand when you're 6'2", 6'3", pucks are going to find you. Not every time. So put the odds in your favor. It's a hard enough position to play. Don't make it any harder.
Perfect. Mitch, any insight, or you want to move on to the next one?
Nope. I think we covered it. The only thing I'll say is that play may have been offside. Pretty close.
I don't know. They're pretty good at checking those things out now. Definitely stoppable. One he wants back. Again with Bob. Okay.
No, now we're going the other way.
Okay.
No, maybe not. Nope, it's Bob again.
Yep.
It's Bob Deck.
That was a little bit jumpy. We're going to have to watch that again. All right, so he kicks it out wide. Again, they're getting beat to that post.
All right, a couple things. One is, that's a hell of a pass by Torrey Krug, who played at Michigan State, and another undrafted free agent defenseman, late bloomer, so just keep that in mind. But to me, I think it's a good goal. I got to be honest. I think it was a great pass. I think it was a good goal. I think Bobrovsky made a move off to the side. Evan, good point. He could have been a little surprised. I mean, but to me, that was a really good pass and a really good tip. And I'll tell you what, goalies, there are times where you're going to get scored on, and I'm sure a few of you have felt it. You're going to get scored on, and you just have to get back on your feet and say, you know what, wow, they made a pretty good play.
I mean, you watch it. I think you're right. They earned this goal.
Yeah.
Good zone entry. I don't know who's driving the net, but he created time and space and presented a target. And then,
that's David Backus, who played at Minnesota State. Another real good, another late bloomer.
Pass comes across, he identifies, and just a good execution. All right, now we got some new goalies.
Heck of a shot, too, right inside the post.
Oh, that's a good guy. To me, sometimes you got to stand there on the bench and just clap your hands and say, that was pretty good.
Oh, nice play by him. I love how he changes the release point, changes the direction right at the end. Makes it so much more difficult. Uses the D-man as a little bit of a screen.
Yeah, Binnington's reaction leads me to believe that he never saw it. Like, look, he kind of resets himself for a second here. I don't think he ever saw that. The way his reaction was, I think it was by him before he knew it.
Yeah, he pulled it in. The D-man was going down to block it. You also had another San Jose guy driving the net. No, and those are big body guys. So it's not easy to find the puck. But I think you're right. He tries to readjust himself, trying to hold his edges. I think he does a good job of holding his edges right away. But as he shifts, there is no lane to really find that release.
Yep. I think six and white was in his way to start with. And plus, that was a lousy airmail from six out of the neutral zone. That's either got to go off the windshield or high in the air. I mean, that's bailing out at 50,000 feet, and that's a good defenseman too.
And again, just to reiterate, right, knowing – all the aspects are so very important. And I'm sure you guys hear this from the coach's side yelling and screaming at your forwards. You got to drive the net. I don't know who that is, but 28, the middle lane drive again, is driving the net, bringing that D, engaging with that D. He's providing more time and space for LeBlanc to find an open area and get that shot off. So great shot, great play by LeBlanc. But again, you know, the goal in my eyes was really created because of that net drive. You just create traffic, you create confusion, you take away eyesight. It makes it so much more difficult. And that's why these players are here playing at this level, because they do it so consistently. Mitch, any feedback?
No, I mean, I think you guys covered. I mean, it's a good shot. It's through a number of bodies. But, I mean, the other thing that, Matt, we've talked about is, I mean, let's look at the situation. It's the second period. It's the 2-1 game. You know, this is where an elite goalie, you know, if you can bail your team out, it's not 3-1. So, I mean, in the end, St. Louis ended up did win the series and obviously the cup. But situational awareness, good goalies have to make saves. I mean, that's our job. We erase mistakes. We have to find a way to find the puck. I don't like the excuse, whether it be a squirt goalie or up to my college guys. I never like the excuse of I didn't see it. It's your job to see it. It's your job to find it, whether there's one body, two body, three body. So, but again, these are NHL goalies against NHL players, and goals are going to happen. There's not a single goalie that makes an all-star team. There's not a single goalie that won a Stanley Cup. There's not a single goalie in the Hall of Fame that has a zero goals against and a 1.00 save percentage. Goals happen. It's, as Dave said, as Matt said, it's how you react.
And that's so many things in life too. It's not always the cards that you're dealt. It's how you play them. In a perfect world, I would be 6'4", but I wasn't dealt that card. I'm sure Dave, you would wish you were a little bit more or less vertically challenged.
I'd still be playing.
Yep. There's a lot of things that, you know, we can hang our hat on of things that would be nice or ideal, but you know, life is all about what you make it. And same thing with goaltending. You know, you could see other players and find success with their platform, and sometimes it's frustrating. But again, you know, another reiterating fact that Dave brought up was, if you're not finding the success now, don't lose motivation. Goaltending is a late blooming position. You have to be in the game to win at the game, so don't quit too early. Don't get frustrated. Stay motivated and continue to try and improve yourself. And again, you know, I really am so grateful to have this opportunity. No one wants to be away from the rink for 3 months. You know, with everything that's going on, it allows us to kind of take a step back, slow down a little bit, reevaluate how we do things. I hope you guys really took this time to work on some of the aspects outside of the rink, such as the off-ice, the conditioning. You know, hopefully these type of discussions with the guests that we've had, I provided you another level of education in the goaltending world. And I know we're all excited to get back after it, but I really am grateful, Dave. Again, let me say thank you for coming on and providing such great insight. Your experience with the ADM model, with all the experience of coaching, scouting, and broadcasting, you know, I really appreciate you coming in and providing a lot of that insight. If you don't mind, could I ask you to repeat the one website that you started at the beginning? I think it was like usahockeygoalie.com.
Yeah, it's www.usahockeygoaltending.com, and there's a ton on it, and it is the life's work of a lot of us that have been in the coaching education program for a long time. When that came to fruition, it was one of the great days for goaltending in our country. And goalies, I'll leave you with this. We have a slogan in Goalie Nation. The hashtag is 51 in 30, and what that means is we here at USA Hockey, we would love to see 51% of the minutes played in the NHL, the American League, and the Women's Pro League be played by American-born goalies by the year 21 and 30. Maybe you'll be a part of that. Let's hope so. But the hashtag right now and our slogan is 51 and 30.
Well, Mitch, any closing thoughts?
No, I mean, it's you know, bittersweet that this is going to be our last Zoom. You know, as you said, I think we've had some great guests, and I think we're ending on possibly the highest note possible with Dave. And I'm very excited to actually coach. I actually have a college goalie coming into the studio tonight. So I'm very excited to coach someone other than my own kid, who might actually listen to me. And, you know, I'm ready to get at it. It's time.
Well, I just want to say how grateful we are for everybody that's joined in on these Zoom calls. Dave, thank you so much for allocating some of your time for us and our goaltenders. I can't thank you enough.
Oh, my pleasure.
And all the goalies, again, one word to leave you with is respect. Respect yourself, respect your family, respect the position that you're playing, and make sure with that word, you know, you respect yourself. You know, put the work in that you deserve. You know, make sure you're putting the right pieces in place to accomplish the goals that you set for yourself. And the only person that can control that is you. So be fully invested, be fully engaged, and look forward to getting back to the rink and enjoy every opportunity to put the pads on. Because sooner rather than later, you'll be on this side of the coin, just like Dave and Mitch, and loving helping out with the next generation of goalies. So enjoy it while your time is there. Everyone stay safe, stay healthy. If you guys need anything, always, always, always reach out. We're always here. Dave, thank you so much. Mitch, always a pleasure. And everybody else, stay safe and healthy. Thanks for today, guys.
Take care, everyone.
Thanks, Dave. Dave, I really appreciate it. That was awesome. Everything that you said reiterated exactly what we've been preaching. So it's so nice to have somebody with such great, such an amazing resume come on and preach the most important pieces, right? We can talk about tactical ways until we're blue in the face, but the strategy is some of the things that so many people miss out on, the higher level pieces. So thank you so much for bringing that into today.
Oh, my pleasure. Listen, I'd love to have stayed for a couple hours, but I unfortunately got to get my kids, this was fun. I like these. If you guys do these again, let me know. I'm always willing to jump in with these.
Well, thank you so much, Mitch. Thanks for coordinating this and reaching out to Dave and getting this all together.
100%. Awesome. Great stuff.
See you guys around a ring soon.
Sounds good, bud. Thank you so much. Enjoy your day.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, Dave.